He said that life and death was in the power of the tongue. He said, be quick to listen and slow to speak and slow to become angry. He said that many fires are burning out of control because of careless sparks spoken from an ill intent. And God's saying, if you fall in love with me, then you'll be able to love someone else.
Yeah.
See, if you don't really love God, then it's really hard for you to love what God loves. But if you love God with a passion, you'll have a fire that will transform people from death to life. I've noticed that sometimes we pray for people and there's a tangible heat that manifests upon our hands. Why is that? It's the fire of God. He said that he baptized them by water and by fire and by the Holy Spirit. That's incredible. Isn't it incredible that God, he doesn't just baptize us by water to be symbolic of, no, you died so that I could live in you, and then you were resurrected on the third day, no longer you who live, but Christ who lives in you, the hope of glory. But he's saying, no, I baptized them by water and by fire and by the Holy Spirit. How many people feel like you're getting fired up right now? Come on! Not only is he here, Emmanuel, God with us, but he's in you. You are the temple of the Holy Spirit. He's filled your vessel so that you can go fill someone else's. When he said, my cup runneth over, the runover factor is what brings contagious Christianity, and most of the church today is dead. Why? Name some reasons. Why do you think that the church abroad, for the most part, needs reformation? Because it's dead. Why do you think that is? Let's hear it. Because they don't allow for the Holy Spirit. The third portion of the Trinity. The power portion. The power portion. Remember he said that in the end times there would be many doctrines of demons and seducing spirits, right? What are those doctrines of demons? Things that they teach against the Holy Spirit. Is a doctrine of demons. David, you raise your hand. Yeah.
You're asking why you're in church.
Yeah.
Because of loving the world rather than loving God.
Loving the world. It's difficult to love God if you're hung up on loving the world that's perishing. Yes.
Because they have religion, but not relationship.
Because they have a form of godliness, but they deny the power of God.
Amen.
Jesus brought the gospel, and it was confirmed by power, by signs, and by wonders. And then he sent out the 12, and he sent them out two by two, and they did the exact same thing that Jesus did, but yet people say, oh, well, that was a long time ago. What's another reason, Mike?
Legalism,
which puts a focus on the law, right? The Lord came to fulfill the law. If the cross didn't actually accomplish what Jesus said that it was there to do, then I can see why they'd be hung up. So God wants us to bring them into the understanding. I was talking to somebody yesterday. I was at a wedding, and I got to do a wedding, and it was really fun to be able to do, hey, brother, come up here. Where's Adam? Is Adam here? Oh, yeah, Adam, come on up here. Hey, brother, we're going to have you testify as to what you saw God do. Brother, come on. Yeah, yeah. Don't be shy. Come on, back row. Yeah, come on, Tex. You're a man of God. Amen. So what happened yesterday? Now, you guys, remember that I don't always have a lot of free time to go out and do weddings. But the Lord specifically told me to do this wedding, and it was his daughter. In fact, she came here, Nicole. She asked me, will you marry me? And I said, oh, I'm already married. She goes, no. I mean, and I said, well, when do you get married? And she told me, and then she brought her man here. Anyways, I blessed them, and the Lord said, it is my will that you marry them. So I was excited. Now, they're not normally here, but they've been here a few times, but this isn't maybe their home church where they're regular attenders. And so I just asked the Lord, you want me to do this? And I don't have a lot of free days, but it was a special day. So it was yesterday. It was Saturday. That was their wedding day. And I got there early to prepare in the Lord, and I just asked the Lord a lot of questions. What do you want to do? And the Lord said, it's about the harvest. So I asked her immediately when she asked if I could do the wedding. I said, can I do an altar call? She goes, well, yeah, I was hoping that you would. I go, great. I'm in. Because see, if people are going to come to salvation, the greatest miracle of all, then I'm in. I want to be a part of the harvest. Anyway, tell us what happened. No, you tell it. What happened? Come on, hold that thing up so that you hear. Here, is it on? Here.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's on. Just hold it up real close, yeah. Or you can tell it, Adam. If he told you, you tell it. Yeah. Thank you. Stay here, though. Yeah, it's okay.
Church down in Olympia, we had a cross back on
the stage. Hold it up real close.
That's really close. We have a cross in the back of the stage, and there was a believing. Everybody got paper and believe. They said, believe the Lord. For those who weren't saved yet, put their names down for those who believe in that they're hoping in. And he made a list of names.
This is at the wedding.
It's about the wedding. He made a list.
They're not getting it. She's asking a question and shows she didn't get it. Okay, so it's not that you didn't get it. We're just going to explain it more clearly. So start over and what happened and where were you? Where were you? Okay, is this mic up loud?
Can you hear me?
Yeah, that's better.
All right. So at his daughter's wedding, there was a lot of people there. And to give you a little precursor, at the church down in Olympia, he made a list of names for those that he was believing for that would be saved. Long list of names. And he nailed it to the back of a cross down there. And in the hopes of believing that those people would come to Christ. All those people were at the wedding. Almost all of those people were at that wedding. Yes. Yeah, everybody but two. Nathan wanted to be a part of something, be a part of the harvest. He got the invitation to give the altar call. Almost all of those people that he put on the list gave their hearts to the Lord.
So there was a lot of people that got saved. Because there was a lot of people that were not saved, that were not walking with Jesus. And so what an amazing thing. What an amazing harvest. I mean, most of the people in the church today are already saved. So that means that the harvest isn't actually in here. It's out there. So here's where we come to get equipped, to get trained, to get powered up on the Lord and on the Holy Spirit. We learn to walk in the gifts, move in the anointing, so we can go out and impact the world that's lost and dying. Amen? So this is exciting. So tell me more.
As Father Brady sits in the front row and he's listening to all these people repeat the prayer and lead me. And those...
Don't be shy. Come on. Eat that microphone. Tell us something. Come on. What happened?
There was a lot of people.
They were really good down home people. And man, it's going to be cool to be in heaven someday and to have some of those people come around. How is it a wedding? And you came up and you did the altar call. And I know some people felt uncomfortable because at the end they said, well, that preacher, you know, he did an altar call. You know what I mean? But I have permission. You know what I mean? So if God gives you permission, then you have the opportunity to impact some people. And the devil hates it when we make a difference for God. But who knows how many people said that prayer. Maybe 70 people said that prayer. Maybe 65 people got saved. And that's probably more people we've seen get saved in the last year here. I don't know how many people have been saved. We've had a lot of salvations here also. But in one day, I'd say that's a successful day in the kingdom. Amen. Yesterday was because of this, the fire of God. How many people want more fire? All you have to do to get more fire is just do the thing that God is asking you to do. You want more fire? Just say, Lord, what would you have me to do? I promise you, if you do the thing that God is calling you to do, you will be full of power. And that fire is contagious. You know, fire can be used for good or it can be used for evil depending on what we're using it for. But let's take a look here. The fire of God. Questions. Is fire good or bad?
Yes.
Well, that depends. That depends on where it comes from or what it's used for, right? What is strange fire? Who knows? Yes. Something from the flesh would be strange fire. Counterfeit or of real fire, or something that grieves the spirit. Yeah, that's good. Yeah, strange fire is from the devil. Strange fire is from rebellion. Strange fire destroys instead of builds up. I love your voices. You guys sound really good. I'm so happy to hear you. Okay, what did God mean when he talked about careless words in James that destroy? Who knows? What did he mean? You guys remember? Many fires burning out of control. One careless spark, 10,000 acres up in smoke. Consider all the wars, all the reasons for divorce. Holy chosen words, guiding people off the course. Will we build or destroy? Will we fill our heart with joy? Capture every thought, every word you employ. There's power in the tongue. You guys remember? Fire. So what's the answer? What did he mean when he talked about careless words that destroy? He talked about speaking things that are from death instead of from life. Oh, I never see what I want to see. I never get I never get answers to my prayer. Those kinds of things are like strange fire. That's a good way to shut down the thing that God wants to do. Begin to speak according to life. Begin to speak according to what you're believing for. Say, Lord, I thank you that everywhere I go, I run into people that I need to meet. Lord, I thank you that everywhere I go, I see people that you preordained for me to be connected to for the purpose of your kingdom. Lord, I thank you that I'm full of your plan because I'm your child. Yes. You have to speak according to what you're believing for. So this says, let's see, is there really a lake of fire?
Yes.
You believe it?
Yes.
See, if you know that there's a lake of fire that's real in Revelation, you don't have to go around and focus on the fire and brimstone message. But if you know that there's really a place where that the lost will spend all of eternity, where there's weeping and there's gnashing of teeth, then you become infused with the passion and the fire of God that none would perish.
Yes.
And you begin to see every person who does not know him as an opportunity for salvation. And then you begin to step out of your comfort zone. And you might even fumble over some words. But I guarantee you, if you don't say anything, no one's going to get saved. See, but if you do say something, you open your mouth and you don't worry about what you will say because the Lord said that the Spirit will give you the words. I promise you, people will get saved. But you have to recognize that they're going to die maybe if you don't say something. But in the world, we're conditioned by this socialism agenda to appeal to what people want and what they like and what they want to hear. I'm not here to tickle ears.
Amen.
I'm here to make a difference. Yeah. I'm on fire for God and I'm passionate. Righteous would take it by force. We need to stop tiptoeing around the tulips and get in the game and be a people of transformation. Amen. I'm serious because you know what? I know the people need reformation. They need a touch from God. They need what's real. There's people who are hurting and they're dying and they don't know what to do. They're depressed, they're sad, they're lonely, they're oppressed, they're feeling destroyed and broken. And God's saying, wake up, church, and go and send the people that I've called you to send, and bring the people that I've called you to bring, and be a contagious, on fire, outrageous, all in, righteous. Because he's in you. If the Savior lives in you, then you might be the only salvation that God will bring before they have one choice, one opportunity. The Savior is alive, and if you don't say something, they may never know him. So, if you've got the Savior in you, you've got to let the Savior out of you. If you've got the Holy Spirit in you, you've got to let the Holy Spirit out of you. You carry life in you. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. If I set my courage in motion, nothing will be impossible for me. You have to speak to yourself according to what you're believing for and see the result that God has on his heart. See, the church is full of religious fat cats. It is not a country club. We're not on a cruise ship.
Amen.
We're on a battleship. We're called the transformation. We're called to raise our voice and get in the face of the dying world and say, there's a better way. Will you come? And when I looked out on the faces there, I saw a lot of people who did not have a fire and a passion and a zeal for the Lord. And I was like, praise the Lord. It was like a Holy Spirit smorgasbord. The Lord targeted those people. I'm telling you right now, all of heaven was looking at those lost and saying, who will say yes? Who will come to me? Who will let me love them and transform them into liberty and real freedom? Because the world is dying, but the kingdom is advancing. Okay, I'm ready. I'm settled down now.
No.
I'm sorry, I thought I was in the Tacoma Dome or something there, trying to reach out to the people in the back. Okay, so what's the difference between the New and the Old Testament? Some people don't know. You know, the way I opened the altar call there at the wedding was this. I said, many of you have been turned off by people who said one thing and did another. It's called hypocrisy, and we're all guilty. So instead of letting that be your excuse to deny God and the things that are good, how about if you let that become your motivation to do it the right way and to tell the truth in love? Some of you don't know where you're going when you were to die. And if today was your last day and the Lord came back and said, are you ready to come to heaven? What would give you the right to be able to get in? Do you know? Do you know where you're going to go when you die if that day were now? How do you know? How can you be so sure? And I said that. What would you say there, Steve?
Because of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ, your Son.
Amen. So, if there's any other reason, I'm a good person, not by works, lest any man should boast, but it's by faith. It's by his grace. It's by faith. We receive the gift of salvation. When you receive the gift of salvation and you know that the Lord said that no, there's no other name under heaven by which we are saved. No other name but the name of Jesus Christ. So you can pray to something else, but that doesn't mean you're going to go where he promised. And so we have to help people understand the simplicity of the gospel message, that he loves you just the way you are, but too much to let you stay the same. So he's going to bring you in deeper. He's going to draw you in. And you're going to get so full of his love and passionately on fire for God, you will be a world changer if you'll allow it. This is a really amazing thing that God would see us, those he foreknew. He also predestined. He calls us co-laborers and joint heirs. He says we've been seated up there, so this is no longer your home. This place is falling apart down here, but heaven is rejoicing because there's souls about to enter the kingdom of heaven. There's a harvest that's plentiful, and the workers are few. And he's saying, will you be my workers? Who will be a worker for God? Who will get in the face of the dying world and tell the truth in love? Let me see your hands. Amen. There's enough people right here to change the entire region. It doesn't take very many on fire, contagious, all in, outrageous lovers of God. And if you love the least of these, then you love him, because he said, if you give them a cold cup of water, you've done this unto me. So we need to be love. Sometimes we feel like if we could just do more, and the Lord's like, well, I did it all, so how about if you just get in the game from the position that I gave you everything? He bankrupted heaven to give you the keys. And we act like we don't have what we need. And the Lord's saying, you've got me. Haven't I given you all? I gave you my son. What more would you want? I empowered you by my spirit. I gave you the keys to my kingdom. I said, when you loose on earth, to be loosed in heaven. When you bind on earth, to be bound in heaven. What more do you need? Are you lacking anything? To call and ask of me, and I will give it to you. If you do not doubt or do not waver, come on. You have it. You have what you need. Success is who you are. Don't pursue what you've already been given. Oh, Lord, I need a breakthrough. Here's the keys to life and death. It's in your mouth and it's in your hand. Now go, ye therefore, now. Okay. Praise the Lord. I think I'm feeling it up here. Okay, let's get it. Oh, I'm feeling some fire, Josh. Come on. I want to see the world get changed by the liberty of God. Real freedom is not in a colorful banner. Real freedom is a person. His name is Jesus. Yes.